So this is joint work with my two previous PhD supervisors, so Pierre Chenet, who is a professor at École Centrale de Lille, Nicolas Daubigeon, who is a professor with the University of Toulouse, Arnaud Doucet, professor at the University of Oxford, and Daniel Pauline, who is now a lecturer at the University of Edinburgh. So as I said, I want to solve Bayesian inference problem. So we'll briefly recall what we mean by Bayesian inference and how we can solve this Bayesian inference problems with Markov-Chain Monte Carlo algorithms. So typically, under the Bayesian paradigm, you are interested in estimating a parameter theta of interest, which is unknown, based on some information brought via some observations, so which will be noted by Y in this presentation. And basically, under the Bayesian paradigm, you will specify a prior distribution with density here pi, which actually denotes the a priori information you have about this parameter theta you want to infer. You will update this prior information thanks to a likelihood function, which with thanks to the Bayes rules, which will lead to the so-called posterior distribution, which is just the distribution of your parameter of interest theta given your observation. And based on this posterior distribution, you might want to estimate, to calculate some quantities based on this posterior distribution, such as Bayesian estimators or credibility regions. So it is particularly important to estimate credibility regions, especially in problems where you do not have a ground truth, such as in astronomical problems, for instance, or in more complicated problems. And basically, all these problems, such as calculating Bayesian estimators, estimating credibility regions, boil down to solve actually an integration problem with respect to your posterior density. So there are many ways to estimate integrals. So one way to estimate this potentially high-dimensional integral is to perform the so-called Monte Carlo integration. So you will estimate this integral via a finite sum of capital N terms involving actually capital N samples, theta N, from the posterior distribution. And so with this Monte Carlo integration, actually you transform this integration problem, potentially very complicated to solve analytically, into a sampling problem where you have to sample now capital N samples from the target posterior distribution. So this type of Monte Carlo integration problems have numerous applications, such as in inverse problems, statistical machine learning, or in order to aggregate some estimators. So there are some challenges associated to this sampling task. So basically, your posterior distribution could be very complicated. So for instance, if you take the negative log of your target posterior density, this negative log, also called energy, potential energy, could have a composite form. So it could be written as follows. So as a sum of B terms, so B potential UI, which might involve also matrices AI acting on your parameter of interest, which adds some difficulty to sample from this posterior distribution. In addition, another difficulty is the fact that some potentials UI could be not smooth. And as such, you cannot use standard MCMC algorithms, such as standard Langevin or Hamiltonian approaches, in order to sample from this posterior distribution. Finally, big bottleneck for MCMC sampling is the fact that your parameter of interest theta might live in a very high dimensional space, so namely, it might live in RD, where D, the dimension, could be very large. And basically, it is well known that actually a lot of MCMC approaches do not scale into high dimensional settings. So this is a challenge I want to tackle in this talk. So as an illustrative example, so in image processing, you have a very common problem, which is image in painting, where you want to solve an inverse problem. So you have a linear inverse problem. So you have your noisy and so you have your original image T, which is damaged by a binary mask H, and where we had also a Gaussian noise to it in order to have the final observation Y, which is actually depicted on the top right of this slide. And since this problem is ill-posed, we will specify a prior distribution. So typically in image processing, the commonly used prior distribution is based on the total variation function in order to smooth this image. And the goal here is to, based on this observation Y on the top right, is to recover the original image, which is depicted on the bottom right. And the challenges associated to this Bayesian inference problem is the following, is that the posterior distribution, pi of theta given y, is not standard. So basically, the TV prior is not conjugate with the Gaussian likelihood. It is not smooth because of the non-smoothness of the total variation prior. And also, it is typically high-dimensional because you have to estimate all the pixels of the image. And typically, for standard images, you have a dimension which could be very large. So here in my example, the dimension is roughly of 10 to the power 5, which is quite large. And so this talk, the aim of this talk is to present both general statistical framework an efficient sampler in order to solve this challenging Bayesian inference problems. And basically, at the heart of my PhD thesis was the use of, as François said, optimization algorithms, and basically the idea of taking inspiration from this efficient optimization algorithm in order to build efficient samplers. So there are actually seminal works, such as in Hamiltonian Monte Carlo or with the unadjusted Langevin algorithms, where people used actually the one-to-one correspondence between gradient descent for you, for instance, and the Langevin diffusion in order to take to build on the first order information brought by the gradient. And so here I will be interested in performing efficient and simple sampling from the posterior distribution with some theoretical guarantees on the scalability in high dimensional problems, but also in big data settings where you have not only a high dimensional parameter to infer, but also a large number of observations, which could be even distributed over a set of nodes within a cluster. So the outline is the following. So we'll first present an approximate statistical framework, which will transform the target posterior distribution into an approximate posterior distribution. I will give you some theoretical guarantees on this approximation under various set of assumptions. I will then present how to perform efficient sampling based on this approximate posterior distribution with some convergence and complexity analysis. And then I will present some experiments in image processing. So to begin with, the statistical framework I will present is called asymptotically exact data augmentation. It is actually a generalization of the so-called data augmentation framework in statistics. I will first briefly present what is data augmentation in statistics before presenting the approximate statistical framework. So typically, data augmentation in statistics is different from data augmentation in machine learning, where in machine learning, you increase the size of your training set in order to have better generalization. Here in statistics, you will introduce some latent variables, basically a latent variable Z, such that if you marginalize the joint distribution of theta and Z, you will recover the initial target distribution. And actually, this framework has numerous well-known advantages, such as it is at the core of a famous expectation maximization algorithm. In for MCMC approaches, it has been used to build a joint posterior distribution, which has simpler full conditionals that can be sampled within a Gibbs sampler, for instance. And it has also been used in order to have better mixing properties. So a typical example in machine learning is the Bayesian lasso, where you have a linear regression problem with Gaussian noise. And if you set the prior distribution to be the Laplace distribution with a regularization parameter tau, actually, you end up with a posterior distribution, which is not standard actually, because the Laplacian distribution is not conjugate with Gaussian latitude. So surrogate proposed by Park and Casella was to build upon the mixture representation of the Laplacian distribution, which is just a mixture between Gaussian random variables and exponential random variables. And you can augment your target posterior distribution using this mixture representation, which will lead you within a Gibbs sampling scheme to have very simple full conditional to sample from, namely Gaussian and inverse Gaussian distributions. So you have an example here where you can use data augmentation in order to simplify your sampling task. Unfortunately, so satisfying this exact marginalization property of your joint posterior distribution is quite a matter of art, actually, because it is a case-by-case search. So basically, I present you a possible way to augment the posterior distribution for Bayesian lasso. If you want to solve a Bayesian logistic regression problem, you have to build upon another data augmentation strategy. And so you have to perform a case-by-case search of the appropriate data augmentation scheme, which leads to efficient MCMC algorithms. So in order to bypass this issue, we want to propose a systematic and simple way to relax this equation one, so this exact marginalization property, which will lead to efficient algorithms. So basically, what I do is that I will introduce a tolerance parameter rho in order to build a joint, an approximate joint posterior distribution with some latent variables z as before, but in such a way that I will not, by marginalizing out this latent variable, I will not recover the target distribution, but an approximation of it, and I will recover this target posterior distribution only in the limiting case. This is why I called this framework asymptotically exact data augmentation. So now the question is how to build this approximate joint posterior distribution. The natural manner to construct this approximate distribution is the following. So you will replace the argument theta in your posterior distribution by your latent variable z, multiply it by some smoothing kernel between z and theta, and you have this approximate joint posterior distribution. And if this smoothing kernel weakly converges toward the Dirac distribution center at theta when rho is sufficiently small, you satisfied this asymptotically exact data augmentation property. And actually, so this is not the only way to augment artificially and in an approximate way your target distribution. But basically, we choose this ID because it leads to a very simple and efficient divide to conquer generalization. So basically, if your target distribution has the following product representation, so it is the product of B terms, so B terms PI, which now might involve some operator AI acting on theta, and which might depend on a subset of your observation YI. And basically, if you apply this scheme, so asymptotic exact data augmentation scheme, to each of the terms within this product sum, you end up with a joint posterior distribution, which will be easier to sample within a Gibbs sampling scheme. So basically, as an illustration, if you want to sample this joint distribution within Gibbs, a Gibbs sampler, you have a following form, where since the latent variables zi are independent condition upon your parameter of interest theta, you can sample these latent variables in parallel. And you can see actually that the conditional distribution is very simple compared to the initial one, because we have only one term pi instead of b, and no operators ai acting on zi. So a priori, simpler full conditional to sample from. And concerning theta, it is just the product of all the smoothing kernels. And so you have, this is the idea behind the introduction of this approximate scheme. So basically now we have to choose the smoothing kernel. So there are many ways to choose this smoothing kernel. In this presentation, I will focus on the Gaussian smoothing kernel in order to have some theoretical guarantees, both on the bias of the approach, but also on the mixing times associated to MCMC algorithms based on this approximate statistical framework. So we'll now present some theoretical guarantees in the case of a Gaussian smoothing kernel. So since I will assume first that the support of my poster distribution is RD, and I will assume that for generality that the poster distribution has the following product form. So it is the product of B terms, where each term is the exponential of minus a potential ui, which involves some operator ai acting on theta. So very general form that you can find either in machine learning problems, but also in signal and image processing problems. And actually, I will perform, as I said before, Gaussian smoothing operations for each of the terms within this product. So basically, I will introduce B Gaussian smoothing kernels for each of the individual term within this product. So this will lead to an approximate poster distribution by marginalizing out the latent variables. And now I am interested in the bias between this approximate poster distribution and the initial one. And basically, we have some theoretical guarantees both for the total variation distance, but also in one Wasserstein, under some classical assumptions. So basically, if you have a potential ui which is Lipschitz continuous, you have a bias of the order rho. And if your potential is sufficiently smooth, you might have a bias of the order of rho square. And you have the same thing with a Wasserstein distance. So basically, an illustration of the tightness of these bounds for an univariate Gaussian toy example. So basically, for this univariate Gaussian example, actually performing this Gaussian smoothing operation actually just boils down to inflate the variance of your initial Gaussian density by a factor of rho square. And basically, we compared in this simple example where you can have explicit form of this total variation and one Wasserstein distance in order to see if the order of the bias in terms of rho is optimal or not. And you can see that actually we have the optimal slope of rho square. So actually these bounds are optimal with respect to rho. Now if your posterior distribution, or if your density has a bounding support, namely the support of pi is now set k, where k lies within RD, is a convex body. So basically, in this case, under a simple assumption, we can also have an upper bound on the total variation distance between pi rho and pi. So this is just a generalization of the results of Nicolas Bros, Alain Durmus, and Eric Moulin in their paper in 2017. So now that I presented both the approximate statistical framework and the associated theoretical guarantees, I will show you how we can efficiently sample from this approximate distribution, poster distribution pi rho. So this will lead to this section where I will present the so-called split gap sampler. So I will just, before presenting this sampler, just recall the form of the poster distribution before presenting the Gibbs sampler. So I will, as for the theoretical guarantees, assume for generality that the poster distribution has the following composite form, where you have matrices AI which might act on theta, and where you, since you, you have a poster distribution and terms that comes from the likelihood some potential UI might depend on the observation. And so I just skip this dependence for clarity, but just recall that some UI might depend on the subset of the observation YI. So an example where you have such a form for the poster distribution is, for instance, in Bayesian logistic regression problems with Gaussian prior, where you have a Gaussian term coming from the prior and a product of n terms, where n is the number of observations which come from the likelihood contribution. And in this case, the challenge is that this poster distribution is not standard, potentially high dimensional. And since the number of observation n could be very large and could not fit on a single machine, you have possibly a distributed data set and you have to scale into this distributed environment. So as I said before, in order to tackle all these problems, I want to build upon the approximate statistical framework I presented before. So I will perform B smoothing operations for each of the individual terms within this product. So I'll introduce this Gaussian smoothing kernel Kaparo. So in the following, I will focus on the Gaussian smoothing case. So I will replace this Gaussian smoothing kernel by a Gaussian one, which leads to this approximate joint posterior distribution. And as I said before, since it is a joint distribution, a natural way to sample from it is to perform Gibbs sampling. So you can do Gibbs sampling with the following advantages, as I highlighted before, is that you can sample in parallel all the latent variables Zi, and the associated conditional distribution are very simple compared to the initial one, because you have a single potential UI plus a Gaussian term and without any matrices acting on Zi. And finally, for the update of the parameter of interest theta, you have just the product of B Gaussian distribution. And so finally, conditional posterior distribution of theta is Gaussian. And so you have a divide to conquer scheme where you have B simpler steps for the Zi, and which are also local. That is, that they only depend on the subset of the observation Yi. And basically, this leads to potential scalability in distributed environments where you have a set of B nodes with a subset of your observations stored in each node. And actually, you can perform efficient distributed sampling by sampling all these latent variables on each node, and then the consensus step at each iteration of your Gibbs sampler get back all these latent variables in order to sample your parameter of interest theta. And so if you want a comprehensive review of this potential scalability in distributed environments, you can see the work by Rendell and co-authors, which actually tackled this problem with the same approach and the same Gibbs sampler. So now I will detail how we can sample efficiently from each step of this Gibbs sampler. So I will begin with the conditional sampling step of the latent variable Zi, which have the following form. And actually, so we show in our paper with Arnaud Doucet and Daniel Pauline that we can sample efficiently and exactly this full conditional of the latent variables with rejection sampling if the tolerance parameter rho is sufficiently small. So basically, the idea behind it is that if rho decreases, this conditional distribution of Zi becomes more and more close to a Gaussian distribution, as illustrated in this example for in the logistic regression case. And actually, you expect that with a Gaussian proposal, you might sample efficiently in big O1 evaluation of UI and its gradient, this conditional distribution. So there is a possible way to perform exact sampling in this case. Concerning the update of parameter of interest theta, I said we have a high dimensional Gaussian distribution. And actually, the main bottleneck in sampling Gaussian distribution is handling the high dimensional matrix, so either the precision or the covariance matrix associated to this Gaussian distribution. So there are numerous efficient sampling approaches in order to sample from this Gaussian distribution. And so you can perform, you can build upon linear algebra techniques such as Lanczos approaches, conjugate gradient sampler, etc., etc. And so I wrote very recently a review paper encompassing all these recently proposed approaches in order to perform efficient sampling. But the take-home message is that we can perform these steps quite efficiently. The main bottleneck is how to sample efficiently the latent variables. So just a quick comparison with another well-known and famous MCMC algorithm, so the unadjusted Langevin algorithm, is that the interesting thing with this split dip sampler is that in the single splitting case, so where B equal to 1, and where you have A1, which is equal to the identity matrix, you have the following two steps for the split dip sampler. When tolerance parameter rho is sufficiently small, you have this update, which is actually one step of the unadjusted Langevin algorithm with step size gamma, which is equal to rho square. And so a natural thing, based on this asymptotic limit, is to compare the unadjusted Langevin algorithm, so its bias, with a bias associated to approximate statistical framework asymptotically exact data augmentation. So we did that, and actually, by comparing with results of Alain Durmus 2019, the bias associated to EULA and the bias associated to our approximate statistical framework, and we can see actually that we have sharper bounds with respect to the tolerance parameter rho, and the main explanation of it is that we have, via convolutions, an explicit form of the approximate density, which is not the case with the approximate density associated to the discretization of the Langevin diffusion. So now another interesting thing with this split dip sampling scheme is that it can be related to a very famous optimization approach, which is the quadratic penalty method. And in order to see this, you can perform map estimation under each full conditional. And actually, by performing this step, you end up with these updates, which are actually the same updates that are within the quadratic penalty method. And so you have a one-to-one correspondence between quadratic penalty methods and split dip sampling. So now I will present some convergence and complexity analysis associated to this dip sampling scheme. So basically, a natural question and an important question for MCMC algorithms is how many steps, how many iterations should I run to obtain a sample from pi? So very close to pi, the initial target distribution. And so this question can be answered by estimating an upper bound on the so-called epsilon mixing time, which is just actually the minimum number of iterations required in order to have an epsilon error on some statistical distance d between your target distribution pi and your Markov kernel at iteration t and started at some initialization nu. And here we are not only interested in providing upper bound of this mixing time, but also in providing explicit bounds with respect to both the dimensionality of the problem, the prescribed epsilon, and some regularity constants associated to the energy or potential u. Because based on this, you can have a rough idea of the behavior of your MCMC algorithms in very large, in high dimensional settings, basically. And the main question is to know whether your MCMC algorithm will have a dependence which is exponential or polynomial with respect to the dimension of the problem. So we first begin with some explicit convergence results. So basically, I just present you a simple case where the matrices AI are all equal to the identity, but actually we have more general results in our paper, but for sake of clarity, I will just present this simple case. And the only assumption I required is the strong convexity property of each of the potential UI. And so based on this assumption, I have the following convergence rates for both one Wasserstein, but also total variation distance, where the convergence rate is governed by an explicit and very simple constant, KSGS, which involves the tolerance parameter, the number of splitting units B, and the strong convexity parameter MI. And so you have at the bottom an illustration on a univariate Gaussian example of the tightness of these bounds. And basically, by combining these convergence results with the bias results I presented before for AXDA, so asymptotically exact data augmentation, we can provide practitioners with explicit guidelines in order to set the number of iterations of the split Gibbs sampler. So basically, these guidelines will have the following form. So you will set some prescribed precision epsilon between 0 and 1 on your total variation distance, so for instance 0.1. You will then, based on this prescribed precision, set the value for your tolerance parameter, which is given here, so it is just epsilon divided by d times m, where capital M is the Lipschitz constant associated to the gradient of your potential u. And then you will start from an initial distribution, which is a Gaussian distribution center in the minimum of U, and with some precision matrix equal to M, capital M. And then you will just have to run capital T iteration of the split Gibbs sampler, where capital T has an explicit form. So actually, we have some theorems and proposition where you have an explicit form of this capital T iteration you have to perform in order to have an epsilon error on your total variation distance. And so as an illustration, so we perform the sampling steps following these guidelines, and we obtain at the bottom right the following histograms with SGS, and you have at the top right the histogram associated to exact sampling for a multivariate Gaussian example, and you can, for a mixture of Gaussians, sorry, and you can see that actually these histograms are difficult to compare actually, and actually this is the aim of such guidelines, because we have an epsilon error between the target density and my Markov kernel. So now what is interesting, as I said before, is to not only have an form of capital T iteration, but actually to have an explicit dependence of these capital T iterations, which are required to have an epsilon error with respect to the dimension of the problem, to the condition number of the problem, and also to the prescribed precision. So we have such guarantees. So for both Wasserstein distance and total variation distance, so for the one Wasserstein distance, we have a guarantee that the complexity associated to the split Gibbs sampler depends up to polylogarithmic factors to the inverse of the prescribed precision epsilon, as many of other state-of-the-art approaches, such as Hamiltonian dynamics or underdamped Langevin approaches. But actually, for epsilon sufficiently small, we showed that the dependence with respect to the condition number of a problem, which is just the ratio between the parameter of the Lipschitz constant associated to the gradient of U and its strong convexity parameter, is actually better. So this dependence is better than the one found for state-of-the-art algorithms. So for small precision epsilon. So we have also similar guarantees for the total variation distance. And basically, we have better dependencies with respect to both the dimension, the condition number kappa, and the prescribed precision compared to EULA. But except in very bad condition situation, we have MALA has better dependencies with respect to both the dimension of the problem and epsilon. So these results were have been proved under the assumption of strong convexity of individual potentials U i. Can weaken this assumption with the following trick. So actually, you can add a Gaussian term to each of these UI, which are now convex but not strongly convex, in order to end up with a strongly convex potential. And based on these results, by just combining our previous results and the triangle inequality, we can show some results, complexity results for log-concave distribution. And for log-concave distribution, by only comparing the split-Gibbs sampler with the EULA and the metropolized random walk, we have better dependencies with respect to both the precision epsilon, but also on capital M, where capital M is the Lipschitz constant associated to gradient of U. And so we have overall better complexity results than these two state-of-the-art works. So this is for the general presentation of the approximate statistical framework and the associated Gibbs sampling strategy. So we'll now show you some experiments and the behavior of the split-Gibbs sampler in image processing examples. So we'll begin with unsupervised image deconvolution with a smooth prior. So basically in this problem, you want to solve a linear inverse problem where, as for image in painting, you have an original image theta, which is shown at the bottom right, which is damaged by a circulant matrix associated to a blue ring kernel. And you have a noisy observation of this image by just adding a Gaussian noise term. And so you end up with an observation Y, which is depicted at the top right. And so you can see that you have a very damaged and noisy image observation, and you want to recover the original image. So since this problem is essentially ill-posed, you will specify, as before, a prior distribution. So here, the prior distribution is quite common in image processing. It has a mean equal to zero and a precision matrix, which is equal to a parameter gamma times a matrix which involves circulant matrices L, capital L, which are circulant matrices associated to Laplacian filter in order to smooth your image. And so basically the main difficulty with this problem is that you end up obviously since both the likelihood and the prior distribution are Gaussian, you end up with a Gaussian posterior distribution, but with the challenge that the associated precision matrix Q cannot be diagonalized easily because the noise actually of the Gaussian noise epsilon is quite complex. Actually, you have this matrix omega which prevents from performing efficient sampling within the Fourier domain, typically in high dimensional problems. So in order to bypass this issue, we propose to build on asymptotically exact data augmentation. So to first apply this framework, this AXDA framework, to the likelihood function. So I will introduce some latent variable Z in order to have the following joint approximate distribution. And actually, the idea of performing this approximation is that concerning the sampling of theta within the split-Gibbs sampler, you end up with Gaussian distribution with a precision matrix which can be diagonalized in the Fourier domain. So actually, you can sample very efficiently in the Fourier domain, so no problem. And for the latent variable Z, you have a Gaussian distribution with a diagonal precision matrix. And actually, you can sample in the real domain the latent variable. And so you simplified this Gaussian sampling problem with two steps which are simpler because I dissociate this matrix omega from the initial precision matrix. And so we compared our approach with other approaches dedicated to Gaussian sampling. And what we showed is that actually we have similar reconstruction properties as the other approaches. But actually, so you can see here in terms of SNR and PSNR, we are quite similar. And in terms of the Markov chain associated to the parameters of a problem, we have convergence results which are quite similar than the other approaches. But basically, the strength of the proposed approach is that it is not dedicated to Gaussian sampling. And as I will present in these second examples for image in painting, we can also apply the same approach, the same algorithm to another problem which is not dedicated, which is not Gaussian. And so in this case, so I presented this problem at the beginning of the talk. So it is image in painting. So you have a decimation matrix H, which is associated to binary mask. And in this case, since the problem is ill-posed, we will choose a prior distribution based on the total variation norm, which has the following form. So it is a scalar parameter tau times the sum of the penalization of the norm of the discrete gradient applied at each pixel of the image theta. And basically, the target posterior distribution has the following form. So it is a Gaussian likelihood times your total variation prior, which can be written as a product of d individual terms. And basically, one of the state of the art to solve this problem is to bypass the non-smoothness of this total variation prior by approximating this non-smooth potential by its Moreau envelope. So it is actually the algorithm called Mayula and proposed by Alain Durmu and co-authors in 2018, which actually, in its update, involves the proximity operator of the total variation norm. So actually, the main problem with this approach is that there is no closed form for calculating this proximity operator, which adds at each iteration of the sampler an additional approximation, because you have to stop your iterative algorithm in order to approximate this proximity operator, and a computational burden because this iterative algorithm, which is a shambles algorithm in order to approximate this proximity operator, is iterative. So actually, this is the main challenge with Mayula. Actually, this challenge has been bypassed by a recent paper by Jalal Fadili and his PhD students, where actually you can bypass the use of shambles algorithm in order to compute these proximity operators. But I will just present how we can bypass this issue also with a proposed AXA approximation and the split Gibbs sampler. So basically, the idea is that we will apply d times the AXA approximation to the individual terms within this product form for the total variation prior. So we will perform d Gaussian smoothing steps in order to end up with this approximate joint posterior distribution. And when you want to sample theta, actually, you have a Gaussian distribution where all the matrices actually are circulant, and you can perform efficiently this sampling stem in the Fourier domain. Concerning the latent variable Z, so basically, just to recall, actually, you cannot perform quite easily this Gaussian sampling stem associated to theta. You have to embed an algorithm proposed by Emily Chouznou and co-authors in order to, because H is not diagonalizable in the Fourier domain, you have to perform a step, but it is quite easy actually to sample from this conditional posterior distribution. Concerning the latent variables, actually, you have this form, and actually, you can, as in the Bayesian lasso, perform a data augmentation step in order to end up with Gaussian and inverse Gaussian conditional distribution to sample from, which are quite easily to sample from. And so you have a very simple and a scalable algorithm in order to solve your Bayesian image in painting problem. So we compared our algorithm with the state-of-the-art Mayula, both in terms of bias. So here we compared the relative bias associated to an exact approach. So actually we ran before the metropolized version of Mayula in order to have a ground truth about the exact parameter gamma alpha here, which encodes the credibility regions of level alpha. And what we can see is that we have a relative error which is acceptable of the order of 0.1% and which is similar to the one associated to Mayula. So we have a similar bias as compared to Mayula, and now we compared the efficiency of the sampling compared to Mayula in both the transient phase and in the transient phase and in the permanent phase. So actually in the transient phase, we can see that actually we converge towards high probability regions faster than Mayula. So we have a faster convergence towards high probability regions. And in terms of stationary, in the stationary phase, actually, we can measure the efficiency of a sampling scheme by measuring the so-called effective sample size ratio, ESSR. And we can see that actually we improved by a factor of 50% the efficiency compared, the sampling efficiency compared to Mayula. So to conclude, I presented a broad and very simple approximate statistical framework where you have to perform multiple convolutions with smoothing kernels of individual terms involved in your target posterior distribution. I did not mention this, but actually this framework with this convolution CT is very similar to approximate Bayesian computation in statistics, where you perform actually you have a smoothing kernel that you apply actually to your likelihood in order to perform likelihood-free inference. So there is some similarity, and actually you can take inspiration from the algorithms proposed in the ABC literature in order to build efficient samplers for the approximate framework I presented before, and actually it has been done by people in the UK. It has also a rich interpretation from both simulation and optimization. So for optimization, I presented a link with quadratic penalty methods, but there are other links basically with the Moreau envelope, etc. And we have actually theoretical guarantees on the bias associated to this approximation. Based on this approximate statistical framework, AXDA, we can perform efficient sampling. So efficient in terms of scalability in high dimensional problems, but also in terms of parallelization, possibly distribution of the sampling. And actually you can see that you have very simple conditional steps within this split Gibbs sampler. And we saw this with some state-of-the-art performances on classical image processing problems. So there are some perspectives associated to this work. So basically, the convergence and complexity analysis we did with Arnaud Doucet and Daniel Pauline actually hold only if you assume exact sampling from your conditional distribution within the split Gibbs sampler. And so this prevents you from using Markov kernels, such as Metropolis, Hastings algorithms or other algorithms, in order to sample from this conditional. So one perspective is to have some convergence and complexity analysis when you sample from the conditional using Markov kernels. There is also a perspective associated to the distributed and scalability of the split Gibbs sampler and basically in asynchronous settings. And also the proposed algorithm has so far been applied only to image and signal processing problems. And actually it will be interesting to see if we have such state-of-the-art performances in challenging machine and deep learning problems by comparing the split Gibbs sampler with the state-of-the-art in machine learning, typically stochastic gradient MCMC with control variance, obviously. So if you are interested in this work, so there are here are some references. So in terms of theory and methods, I have some papers on this and some applications published in ICASP and MLSP conferences. And the code also associated to the results of these papers is publicly available on GitHub. So thank you for your attention. And if you have any question, do not hesitate. Thank you.